Ah, ele vai também, que é o mais um episódio, mas esse book lá vindo da book lá And today we are on an extremely special episode because today we are on episode number 118. Can you get it, guys? This is blowing my mind. We are going to make 118 episodes of the greatest book club in the world. Damn! It's a lot. And if you can see, today I made my kippa, my yarmulke, to the background. And you see, I have a nice friend over here. See, I don't know how you call this beard. I know what is the name of this beard. But her good friend, they tell her, hey, on my flying across Israel, I saw a great podcast, a great book club, and you must go to visit him. So she sent me a message, she sent me this beard and with a letter, and she said, Sup AK, my beard want to be a guest in your show, can you get us? And I said, of course, and you see, she's extremely excited about it. She's extremely excited about it, and if you want to check her out, you can say hello to her. You know, when you can find her, 123. Kadeem, you can find her on Good Fun. And this grand background was created by Medusa Noll on 12th of May 2019. And of course, we leave a thumb up. And if you want to get the full resolution of the picture, left click on it, and then right click, Shivrat Munam Shem, save pictures, save images. And kadeem, you got a picture. Thank you very much for Medusa Noll, and thank you very much for this nice lady for coming to the podcast. And guys, if you're new to the channel, welcome. If you're not familiar with the channel, welcome back. My name is Eke, and I'm the host. And on this podcast, we are working together on English speaking level, reading level, and on our communication skills to communicate well through the camera. And of course, we are getting together our confidence to stand in front of the camera and to appear on social media and to just put our face and our message to share it with the world. And today we continue. I'm doing so because I truly believe that English is the number one tool that each one of us must acquire in order to be successful in life. And the second tool that is going to help us a lot is to know how to communicate well through the camera. Because as we see, the whole world is moving and shifting from person-to-person meeting to a Zoom meeting. And from consuming our content from the, I've said, not from the television, from the original television, from like the traditional television, we are moving to consume our content from the social media, from a sites like YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and that give us a huge opportunity to get involved in this content creation. Because in previous days, if you want to make your own show, you need the connection to be on the TV show, to be on a special channel, and you need a lot of money from the equipment that you need. But in this day, you only need the only thing that you need to get a extremely good quality podcast like this. Just you need a green screen, a web camera, the computer, you know, just with internet and a nice mic. Yeah. And you can find all of this on your smartphone. So if you have a smartphone, you can start creating content and share messages with the world. And because English is the number one, is an international language. So if you know how to communicate well in English, and if you know how to make a good content in English, so you can open yourself to worldwide international audience. So that's why I think that to know English and to know to communicate well for the camera and to have a confidence to stand before the camera is really important. And today we are continuing with our journey with Trump, the art of the deal by Donald J. Trump, the president of the United States. And to tell you guys this, you know, I really love this book. It's easy reading, and has a lot of nice stories. And compared to the last book that we read, The Denial of Death, it's just easy going. By the way, the Denial of Death, great book. You definitely want to watch the series of it. You want the playlist of it in the channel playlist. So without any more introduction, and if you know to read more about the President Trump, or to check out the book, you got the link to it in the description below also. So let's go, let's start our podcast. So the Art of the Deal, page 44. Written by Donald J. Trump, read by the meat. The legend, the man and only, the man himself. Give me some drum, please. Young boy, AK. That's what's up, that's what's up, that's me. Let's go. So chapter two, trump counts. The elements of the deal. My style of deal making is quite simple and straightforward. I aim very high, and then I just keep pushing and pushing and pushing to get what I am after. Sometimes I settle for less than I thought, but in most cases, I still end up with what I want. More than anything else, I think deal making is an ability you are born with. It is in the genes. I don't say that egotistically. I don't say that egotistically. It's not about being brilliant. It does not take a certain intelligence, but mostly it's about instincts. You can take the smartest kid at Barton, the one who gets straight A's, and there's a 170 IQ, and if he doesn't have the instinct, he will never be a successful entrepreneur. Moreover, most people who do have the instincts, will never recognize that they do, because they don't have the courage or the good fortune to discover the potential. Somewhere out there are a few men with more innate talent at golf than Jack Nicholas, or women with greater ability at tennis than Chris Evert or Martina Navratilova. But they will never lift a club or swing a racket, and therefore will never find out how great they could have been. Instead, they will be content to sit and watch stars perform on television. When I look back at the deals I've made and the ones I've lost on that path, I see certain common elements, but unlike the real estate and vagalist you see all over television those days, I can't promise you that by following the prospect I'm about to offer you will become a millionaire overnight. Unfortunately, life rarely works that way. And most people who try to get rich quick end up going broke instead. As for those among you, who do have the genes, who do have the instinct, and who could be highly successful, well, I still hope you won't follow my advice, because that will just make it a much tougher world for me. Title, Think Big. I like thinking big. I always have. To me, it's very simple. If you're going to be thinking anyway, you might as well think big. Most people think small, because most people are afraid of success, afraid of making decisions, afraid of winning. And that gives people like me a great advantage. My father built a low income and a middle income buildings in Brooklyn and in Brooklyn and Queens. But even then, I gravitated to the best location. When I was working in Queens, I always wanted the forest steels. And as I grew older and perhaps wiser, I realized that forest steels was great, but forest steels isn't Fifth Avenue. And so I began to look towards Manhattan, because at a very early age, I had a true sense of what I wanted to do. I wasn't satisfied just to earn a good living. I was looking to make a statement. I was out to build something monumental, something worth a big effort. Plenty of other people could buy and sell little brownstones or build a cookie cutter red brick buildings. What attracted me was a challenge of building a spectacular development on almost 100 acres by the river on the west side of Manhattan, on creating a huge new hotel next to Grand Central Station at Park Avenue and 42nd Street. The same sort of challenge is what attracted me to Atlantic City. is nice to build a successful hotel. It is a lot better to build a hotel attached to a huge casino that can earn 50 times what you had ever earned renting hotel rooms. You are talking a whole different order of magnitude. One of the keys to thinking big is total focus. I think of it almost as a controlled neurosis, which is a quality I've noticed in many highly successful entrepreneurs. They are obsessive, they are driven, they are single-minded, and sometimes they are almost maniacal. But it's all channeled into their work. Whereas some people are paralyzed by neurosis, the people I'm talking about are actually helped by it. I don't say this trait leads to a happier life or a better life, but it is great when it comes to getting what you want. This is particularly true in New York real estate, where you are dealing with some of the sharpest, toughest, and most vicious people in the world. I happen to love to go up against those guys, and I love to beat them. Title: Protect the downside. The downside and the upside will take care of itself. People think I'm a gambler. I've never gambled in my life. To me, a gambler is someone who plays the slot machines. I prefer to own slot machines. It is a very good business being the house. It's been said that I believe in the power of positive thinking. In fact, I believe in the power of negative thinking. I happen to be very conservative in business. I always go into the deal anticipating the worst. If you plan for the worst, if you can live with the worst, the good will always take care of itself. The only time in my life I didn't follow that rule was with the USFL. I bought a losing team in a losing league on a long shot. It almost worked. Through our antitrust suit. But when it didn't, I had no fallback. The point is that you can't be too greedy. If you go for a home run on every pitch, you are also going to strike out a lot. I try never to leave myself too exposed, even if it means sometimes settling for a triple, a double, or even, on rare occasion, a single. One of the best examples I can give is my experience in Atlantic City. Several years ago, I managed to piece together an incredible site on the boardwalk. The individual deals I made for parcels contingent on my being able to put together the whole site. Until I achieved that, I didn't have to put up very much money at all. Once I stumbled the site, I didn't rush to start construction. That meant I had to pay the current charges for a longer period. But before I spent hundreds of dollars and several years of construction, I wanted to make sure I got my gaming license. I lost time, but I also kept my exposure much lower. When I got my license. On the boardwalk site, Holiday Inns came along to offer to be my partner. Some people said, "You don't need them. Why give up 50% of your profits?" But Holiday Inns also offered to pay back the money I already had in the deal, to finance all the construction, and to guarantee me against losses for 5 years. My choice was whether to keep all the risk myself and own 100% of the casino, and own 100% of the casino, or settle for a 50% stake without putting up a dime. It was an easy decision. Bowen Hilton, by contrast, took a bolder approach when he built his casino in Atlantic City. He wanted to get opened as quickly as possible. He paid for a license and began construction on a $400 million facility at the same time. But then, two months before the hotel was scheduled to open, Hilton was denied the license. He ended up selling to me at the last minute, under a lot of pressure, and without a lot of other options. I renamed the facility Trump Castle, and it is now one of the most successful hotel casinos anywhere in the world. Titan, maximize your options. I also protect myself by being flexible. I never get too attached to one deal or one approach. For starters, I keep a lot of balls in the air, because most deals fall out, no matter how promising they seem at first. In addition, once I've made a deal, I always come up with at least a half dozen approaches to making it work, because anything can happen, even to the best laid plans. For example, if I hadn't gotten the approval I wanted for Trump Tower, I could always have built an office tower and done just fine. If I had been turned down for licensing in Atlantic City, I could have sold the site I have assembled to another casino operator at a good profit. Perhaps the best example I can give is the first deal I made in Manhattan. I got an option to push the Penn Central Railroad at West 34th Street. My original proposal was to build a middle income housing on the site with government financing. Unfortunately, the city began to have financial problems and money for public housing suddenly dried up. I didn't spend a lot of time feeling sorry for myself. Instead, I switched to my second option and began promoting the site as ideal for a convention center. It took 2 years of pushing and promoting, but ultimately the city did designate my site for the convention center, and that's where it was built. Of course, if they hadn't chosen my site, I would have come up with a field approach. Damn, Donald, you're good. Title, know your market. Some people have a sense of the market, and some people don't. Steve Spielberg has it. Lee Coker of Chrysler has it. And so does Judith Kranz in a way. Woody Allen has it. For the audience, he cares about reaching. And so does Sylvester Stallone, as the other end of the spectrum. Some people criticize Stallone, but you have got to give him credit. I mean, he is a man who is just 41 years old, and he's already created two of the all-time great characters, Rocky and Rambo. To me, he's a diamond in the rough type. A genius purely by instinct. He knows what the public wants, and he delivers it. I like to think I have that instinct. That is why I don't hire a lot of number of conscious crunchers. And I don't trust fancy marketing surveys. I do my own surveys and draw my own conclusions. I'm a great believer in asking everyone for an opinion before I make a decision. It's a natural reflex. If I'm thinking of buying a piece of property, I will ask the people who live nearby about the area, what they think of the schools and the crime and the shops. When I'm in another city and I take a cab, I always make it a point to ask the cab driver questions. I ask and ask until I began to get a gut feeling about something. And that is when I make a decision. I have learned much more from conducting my own random surveys than I could ever have learned from the greatest of consulting firms. They send a crew of people down from Boston, rent a room in New York, and they charge you $100,000 for a lengthy study. In the end, it has no conclusion and takes so long to complete that if the deal you were considering was a good one, it will be long gone. The other people I don't take too seriously are the critics, except when they stand in the way of my projects. In my opinion, they mostly write to impress each other, and they are just as swayed by fashions as anyone else. One thing it is stained glass doors they are praising to the skies. The next week they are rediscovered old, and they are celebrating a little and end ornamentation. While very few of them have is any feeling for what the public wants, which is why if those critics ever try to become developers, they'd be terrible failures. Trump Tower is a building the critics were skeptical about before it was built, but which the public obviously liked. I'm not talking about the sort of person who inherited the money, say 175 years ago, and lives on 84th Street and Park Avenue. I'm talking about the wealthy Italian with a beautiful wife and the red Ferrari. Those people, the audience I was after, came to Trump Tower in droves. The funny thing about Trump Tower is that we ended up getting a great architectural reviews. The critics didn't want to review it well because it stood for a lot of things they didn't like at the time. But in the end, it was such a gorgeous building that they had no choice but to say so. I always follow my own instincts, but I'm not going to kill you. It's also nice to get good reviews. Title, use your leverage. The worst thing you can possibly do in a deal is seem desperate to make it. That makes the other guy smell blood. And then you're dead. The best thing you can do is deal from strength and leverage. And leverage is the biggest strength you can have. Leverage is having something the other guy wants. Or better yet, needs. Or best of all, simply can't do without. Unfortunately, that isn't always the case. Which is why leverage often requires imagination and salesmanship. In other words, you have to convince the other guy it's in his interest to make the deal. Back in 1974, in an effort to get the city to approve my deal to buy the Commodore Hotel on East 42 and Street, I convinced its owners to go public with the fact that they were planning to close down the hotel. After they made the announcement, I wasn't shy about pointing out to everyone in the city what a disaster a boarded up hotel would be for the Grand Central area and for the entire city. When the board of Holiday Inns was considering whether to enter into a partnership with me in Atlantic City, they were attracted to my site because they believed my construction was farther along than that of any other potential partner. In reality, I wasn't that far along, but I did everything I could, short of going to work at the site myself, to assure them that my casino was practically Finished. My leverage came from confirming an impression they were already predisposed to believe. When I bought the Vestia side, Rail Yards, I didn't name the project Television City by accident. And I didn't choose the name because I think it's pretty. I did it to make a point, keeping the television networks in New York. And NBC in particular is something the city very much wants to do. Losing a network to New Jersey would be a psychological and economic disaster. Leverage. Don't make deals without it. Title. An NCO location. Perhaps the most misunderstood concept in all of real estate is that the key to success is location, location, location. Usually that is said by people who don't know what they are talking about. First of all, you don't necessarily need the best location. What you need is the best deal. Just as you can create leverage, you can enhance a location through promotion and through psychology. When you have a 57 Fifth Street and the Fifth Avenue as your location, as I did with Trump Tower, you need less promotion. But even there, I took it a step further by promoting Trump Tower as something almost larger than life. By contrast, Museum Tower, two blocks away, and built above the Museum of Modern Art, wasn't marketed well, never achieved an aura, and didn't command nearly the price we did at Trump Tower. Location also has a lot to do with fashion. You can take a mediocre location and turn it into something considerably better just by attracting the right people. After the Trump Tower, I built Trump Plaza on a site at Third Avenue and 61 Street, street that I was able to purchase very inexpensively. The truth is that Third Avenue simply didn't compare with Fifth Avenue as a location, but Trump Tower had given a value to the Trump name, and I built a very striking building on Third Avenue. Suddenly, we were able to command premium prices for very wealthy and successful people who might have chosen Trump Tower if the best apartments hadn't been sold out. Today, Third Avenue is a very prestigious place to live, and Trump Plaza is a great success. My point is that the real money isn't made in real estate by spending the top dollar to buy the best location. You can get killed doing that, just as you can get killed buying a bad location, even for a low price. What you should never do is pay too much, even if that means walking away from a very good site, which is all a more sophisticated way of looking at location. Title, get the word out. Word, W-O-R-D. You can have the most wonderful product in the world, but if people don't know about it, it's not going to be worth much. There are singers in the world with voices as good as Frank Sinatra's, but they are singing in their garages because no one has ever heard of them. You need to generate interest, and you need to create excitement. One way is to hire public relations people and pay them a lot of money to sell whatever you have got. But to me, that is like hiring outside a consultant to study a market. It is never as good as doing it myself. One thing I've learned about the press is that they're always hungry for a good story, and the more sensual, the better. It is in the nature of the job, and I understand that. The point is that if you are a little different, or little out outrageous. Or if you do things that are bold or controversial, the press is going to write about you. I've always done things a little differently. I don't mind controversy. I don't mind controversy. And my deals tend to be somewhat ambitious. Also, I achieve a lot when I was very young, and I choose to live in a certain style. The result is that the press has always wanted to write about it. I'm not saying that they necessarily like me. Sometimes they write positively, and sometimes they write negatively. But from a pure business point of view, the benefits of being written about have far outweighed the drawbacks. It's really quite simple. If I take a full page ad in the New York Times to publicize a project, it might cost $40,000. And in any case, people tend to be skeptical about advertising. But if the New York Times writes even a moderately positive one column story about one of my deals, it doesn't cost me anything, and it's worth a lot more than $40,000. The funny thing is that even a critical story, which might be harmful personally, can be very valuable to your business. Television City is a perfect example. When I bought the land in 1985, many people, even those on my west side, didn't realize that those 100 acres existed. Then I announced I was going to build the world's tallest building on the site. Instantly, it became a media event. The New York Times put it on the front page. Dan Rather announced it on the evening news. And George Will wrote a column about it in Newsweek. Every architecture critic had an opinion, and so did a lot of editorial writers. Not all of them liked the idea of the world's tallest building. But the point is that we got a lot of attention, and that alone creates value. The other thing I do when I talk with reporters is to be straight. I try not to deceive them or to be defensive, because those are precisely the ways most people get themselves into trouble with the press. Instead, when a reporter asks me a tough question, I try to frame a positive answer, even if that means shifting the ground. For example, if someone asks me what negative effects the world's tallest building might have on the west side, I turn the tables and I talk about how New Yorkers deserve the world's tallest building, and what a boost it will give the city to have the tallest again. When a reporter asks why I build only for the rich, I note that the rich aren't the only ones who benefit from my buildings. I explain that I put thousands of people to work on who might otherwise be collecting unemployment, and that I add to the city's tax base every time I build a new project. I also point out that buildings like Trump Tower have helped spark New York's Renaissance, I think. Renaissance. Renaissance. To finally key to the way I promote is bravado. I play to people's fantasies. People might not always think big themselves, but they can still get very excited by those who do. That is, again, because I think it's important. People might not always think big themselves. but they can get but they can still get very excited by those who do. Nice one, nice quote. That is why a little hyperbole never works. People want to believe that something is the biggest and the greatest and the most spectacular. I call it a truthful hyperbole. B-O-L-E, hyperbole. It's an innocent form of exaggeration and a very effective form of promotion. Title, fight back. Much as it pays to emphasize the positive, there are times when the only choice is confrontation. In most cases, I'm very easy to get along with. I'm very good to people who are good to me. But when people treat me badly or unfairly, try to take advantage of me, my general attitude all my life has been to fight back very hard. The risk is that you will make a bad situation worse. And I certainly don't recommend this approach to everyone. But my experience is that if you are fighting for something you believe in, even if it's means a line eating some people along the way, things usually work out for the best design. When the city unfairly denied me on Trump Tower, the standard text break every developer had been getting. And I fought them in six different courts. It cost me a lot of money. I always considered the highly likely to lose. And people told me it was a novel situation politically. I would have considered it worth the effort regardless of the outcome. In this case, I won, which made it even better. When everything is once my partners at the Trump Plaza Hotel and casino in Atlantic City, really a casino that consistently performed among the bottom 50% of casinos in town, I fought them very hard and they finally sold out their share to me. Then I began to think about trying to take over the Holiday Inn's company altogether. Even if I never went on the offensive, there are a lot of people gunning for me now. One of the problems when you become successful is that jealousy and envy and envy inevitably follow. There are people. I categorize them as life's losers, who get their sense of accomplishment and achievement from trying to stop others. As far as I'm concerned, if they had any real ability, they wouldn't be fighting me. They'd be doing something constructive themselves. Title. Deliver the goods. You can't con people, at least not for long. You can create excitement. You can do wonderful promotion and get all kinds of press. And you can throw a little hyperbole. But if you don't deliver the goods, people will eventually catch on. I think of Jimmy Carter. After he lost the election to Ronald Reagan, Carter came to see me in the office, to see me in my office. He told me he was seeking contributions to the Jimmy Carter Library. I asked how much he had in mind. And he said, Donald, I would be very appreciative if you contributed $5 million. I was dumbfounded. I didn't even answer him. But that experience also taught me something. Until then, I had never understood how Jimmy Carter became president. The answer is that as poorly qualified as he was for the job, Jimmy Carter has a nerve the guts, the balls, to ask for something extraordinary. That ability, above all, helped him to help him get elected a president. But then, of course, the American people caught on pretty quickly that Carter couldn't do the job. And he lost in a landslide when he ran for a re-election. Ronald Reagan is another example. He's so smooth and so effective a performer that he completely won over the American people. Only now, nearly 7 years later, the people beginning to question whether there is anything beneath that smile. I see the same thing in my business, which is full of people who talk a good game but don't deliver. When Trump Tower becomes successful, a lot of developers got the idea of imitating an atrium, as they ordered their architects to come up with a design. The drawings would come back, and they would start costing out the job. What they discovered is that the bronze escalators were going to cost $1 million extra. $1 million extra. And the waterfall was going to cost $2 million. And the marble was going to cost many millions more. They saw that it all added up to many millions of dollars. And all of a sudden, those people with those great ambitions would decide, well, let's forget about the atrium. The dollar always talks in the end. I'm lucky because I work in a very, very special niche at the top of the market, and I can afford to spend top dollar to build the best. I promoted the hell out of Trump Tower, but I also had a great product to promote. Title contain the cost. I believe in spending what you have to, but I also believe in not spending more than you should. When I was building a low income housing, the most important thing was to get it built quickly, inexpensively, and adequately, so you could rent it out and make a few bucks. That is when I learned to be cost conscious. I never threw money around. I learned from my father that every penny counts. Because before too long, your pennies turn into dollars. To this day, if I feel a constructor is overcharging me, I will pick up the phone, even if it's only for $5,000 or $10,000, and I will complain. People say to me, "What are you bothering for over a few bucks? My answer is that the day I can't pick up the telephone and make a 25 cents call to save $10,000 is the day I'm going to close up shop again. My answer is that the day I can't pick up the telephone and make a 25 cent call to save $10,000 is the day I'm going to close up shop. The point is that you can dream great dreams. But they will never amount to much if you can turn them into reality at a reasonable cost. At the time of building Trump Plaza in Atlantic City, banks were reluctant to finance new construction at all, because almost every casino up to then had experienced tens of millions of dollars in cost overruns. We brought Trump Plaza in on budget and end on time. As a result, we were able to open for Memorial Day weekend and the start of the high season. By contrast, Bob Gassion, the penthouse, Bob Gassion of Penthouse, has been trying for the past 7 years to build a casino on the boardwalk site right next to ours. All he has to show for his efforts is a rusting. Gap build the frame and tens of millions of dollars in lost revenues and squandered killing costs. Even small jobs can get out of control if you're not attentive, if you're not attentive. For nearly 7 years, I watched from the window of my office as the city tried to rebuild the Wollman Ring in Central Park. At the end of the time, millions of dollars that had been wasted and the job was further from being completed than when the work began. They were all set to rip out the concrete and start over when I finally couldn't stand it anymore, and I offered to do it myself. The job took 4 months to complete at a fraction of the city's cost. Title: Have fun. I don't kid myself. My life is very fragile, and success doesn't change that. If anything, success makes it more fragile. Anything can change without a warning, and that is why I try not to take any of what's happens too seriously. And the doctor says, why so serious? And that is why I try not to take any of what's happens too seriously. Money was never a big motivation for me. Expect as a way to keep score. The real excitement is playing the game. I don't spend a lot of time worrying about what I should have done differently or what is going to happen next. If you ask me exactly what this I'm about to describe all end up to in the end, I'm not sure I have a very good answer. Expect that I had a very good time making them. So guys, this was the episode of today, and I really have to tell you, I really had fun for recording this episode, because I truly love this book. It's a light, really easy going, really easy English, and I really enjoy this book. So guys, if you already love this book, please press the like button. Let me know in the comments if you love this book or not, and what you are thinking about it. And guys, go out and spread the word, make a difference because you want to enjoy the process. Like, I started this podcast because I want to improve my English, and now I figure out that I really like to talk on the internet. And I love to communicate with you guys, and I really love the cameras, and I get excited about it. And you never know where the things that you are really passionate about are going to take you guys. And I don't know where this is going to take me, but I'm sure it's going to give me a nice opportunity along the way in the future. So guys, make sure to inspire the woman, go out there, have a great time with your family, friends, and neighbors, and stay safe, stay in home, and this coronavirus is behind us. Because I know there's a lot of people that are still suffering from the coronavirus, and it's all okay, families, all okay, book club, community standing, our best wishes to you guys, and we are praying for you to feel better and to have a better times. And we want to support each other. And if you want to be a guest on my podcast so we can talk with each other, please let me know in the comment below, in the description below. And that is for the episode today, guys. So I hope to see you guys tomorrow for the next chapter, the next episode, and the next chapter, chapter 3, going up. Yeah, it's looking nice, going up. Let's see what he's talking about. So guys, have a great time, take care of yourself, and I'll see you tomorrow, guys, for the next episode of the Get This Book Club in the Board. Thank you, book club. Until then, have a great time. Take care of yourself and bye-bye.